Yeah, so tonight I'm going to talk to you about two different species of birds. One's the bango, and we mainly refer this bird to. The other one's one of my favourite birds, the diamond flytail, the diamond sparrow. So, bit of an overview. Where did the bango come from? Who keeps bangos? Who's kept bangos in the past? A lot of the colours that we don't see these days existed many years ago, and I'll get into that in a minute. Talking about description. When I talk about where did they come from, where did the bird originate from? What was the original species? What's the belief?
Belief. You want to answer?
Yeah, go, Joe. What do you believe?
The belief is it's a mixture of eight different communities with Japanese bird.
Close to what the research was called. Diet, nutrition, health, sexing differences, mouth markings. Who's aware that each different species of finch has a different mouth marking on top of the palate of their mouth? Right? So we'll talk about that. Breeding and the colour mutations. So where do they come from? The belief is that it's a domesticated form of the white-rumped munya. And it originated from Southeast Asia, South and Southeast Asia. And as Joe mentioned, the Chinese and the Japanese, they're the ones that have known to domesticate the species over 250 years ago. So if you look at anything to do with the bangos in Japan, mainly in Japan these days, they've got quite a lot of different mutations and colours. I don't know of any other bird that's been domesticated for over 250 years, to my knowledge. Could be wrong.
Canary.
Canary? Well, there you go. Or end up, yeah, domesticated chook. So, but for a finch, probably one of the oldest domesticated species we have. As you can see here, that's the wild form of the white rumps. This shot down here is a little bit hard to see, it's cut off a little bit, but that's a chop itself. The bird belongs to Paul, or used to belong to Paul. So yeah, they're very similar in colours, and I'll show you a few more colours in a second. So their names, Bengalese Manakin, the Munya, Bengalese Finch, and in the US they're called the Society Finch. Anyone's kept them before, you'll know why they're called the Society Finch, because when it comes to bedtime, even before it starts getting dark, they all pile in. You might have 10 of them in a cage. I'll try to pile into that one nest to roost for the night. Diet, nutrition. So as usual, you have good quality finch mix. When I'm breeding, I normally give them a separate container of plain canary and the red pannikin. Canary for the protein and the red pannikin just because it's easy to feed the younger, the smaller chicks. Greens, I get sprouted French millet, red pannikin, a bit of safflower and mung beans. Paul Henry taught me the mung bean trick.
Yeah, the mung beans.
For the protein. So. Mixed in with a little bit of Livermole. Livermole is mainly used for horse nutrition as a supplement. It's got a lot of minerals and vitamins in that. Who else uses Livermole? Who's heard of it? Sam?
Where do you get it from?
So you buy it it comes mainly in 1-2 kilo bags, or bigger bags, I believe, from any produce store. But yeah, it's got quite a lot of nutrients in it. A lot of the guys at the Hunter Valley use it. And it's like an orangey powder. Oh, okay. So just put a few little spoonfuls in that with the sprouted seed or some food, whatever you're feeding. But yeah, it's quite nutritious. As usual, anything else? Sprouting seed heads, milk thistle, a bit of endive, bok choy, corn on the cob, lemonese cucumber, give a little bit of boiled egg, not much, the shell grit, and a bit of finch soft food when they're brewing. Who keeps mangoes now beside Joe? Health, like pretty much all the other birds, I use Noxidecan Plus for worming. I do mix it up with a bit of worm-out gel every now and then. I breed mainly my birds in flight cages, large flight cages with the bangos, so they don't really pick up that many worms and things like that, so because they're not on the ground fossicking around and there's no other birds in with them. Baycocks for treating coxie, that's normal. Turbo sole, that's used, it's also marketed as Ronnie Bet. mainly in the US, they market as Ronnie Bet. That's used to treat Foxoma and stomach bugs in birds if they get giardia or things like that. Hit them with this Turbosol. It's only, it comes in a powder form, put a little bit of the water. But that normally picks them up quite well. It sorts out his crook stomach. So it's sexing differences. This is quite a debatable subject sometimes. True sexing method. Bob will probably say this, cockbird will always sing. Hen doesn't. So another theory is, if you look at the underside of the mandible beak, cockbird's got the bigger U, more bigger radius, whereas the hen bird will have the sharper beak. I've noticed too, the cockbird on top of the mandible will be curved further and longer rather than the hen. But yeah, the trick is the song. They'll sit up, they'll bob, and the cockbird will sing away. I've never seen a hen do it. Paul, you ever seen a hen sing?
I think they can chatter a bit when they come into colour. And,
but,
yeah.
Not seem like the cock, yeah. Mouth marking. So as I said, each species has a unique pattern on the underneath on the palate. There's been a bit of research by a few guys back in 1996 and 72 that found that the mouth markings in the Bengo of the pure self Bengalese, I'll show you what I'm talking about there in a minute, and the white rump munya that I spoke about earlier, are the same, but different forms of different munias, such as take a chestnut or one of the nuns, they're different. The mouth markings are different. So the theory is that the mouth markings act as a guide for the parents to find the mouth of the young chick in the dark nest cavity. That's the theory behind it. Markings also combined with head movements and begging also act as a trigger to stimulate the parent bird to feed the chick in the nest. Breeding, October to April, I find best. Cock and hens both incubate, and they normally construct in a nest box or a cane, one of those cane baskets, like I've got off the back there. Live around about 7 to 8 years. Clutch size 4 to 6, sometimes bigger, sometimes smaller. 14 to 15 days as per normal incubation period. And they fledge around 19 to 25. Fairly easy to breed. Some people look at it as a nothing bird, look at it like a zebra, but once you get into the colours of the mutations...
Hang on, he's got another
answer. Some people would love them, obviously. Hey, all like many years ago, on the Aussie Finch Forum, Paul Kerbal posted a note saying, I haven't seen a pastel dolphin for a long time. I thought, I read one of them not that long ago. So this bird come out of a ginger coloured bird, or a red bird, whatever you like to call it. But yeah, since then, we've bred heaps. So also bred a few like this in the crested form, with the crest on the head. So when we spoke about the self, this is one of Paul's birds here. That's a chocolate self. That's what I call a chocolate self. Correct me if you think I'm wrong. But yeah, that's the wild type colour. This is one of my birds I bred. This is a ginger self, and this is one of Paul's. So, to my knowledge, self only come in two colours in Australia.
The chestnut in the middle.
Yeah, the chestnut, sorry, as well. So, most of you are probably used to seeing a pied bengo, lots of white through it. So,
isn't there a white one and white yourself?
A pure white? Yeah. Not, well, there's not that many here that I know of.
But wouldn't it be classified as a self?
I don't believe so.
It's like a clear canary. It's like 100% pied top.
Yeah, the first one. So we speak about pieds. So you see them in all different combinations of colours mixed with the white. So these are probably the chocolate and chocolate and white, that's probably the most common that you tend to see. So crested, I don't see that many around anymore. You just see them, but they're not that common. This is one of my young ones I bred last year. And there are people chasing crested because they're just, you don't find them, you don't see them around that often. Saddleback, there's probably about 20 or 30 different combination of colours, but the saddleback obviously for the saddle in the back. Out of the saddleback you might breed a nest of, put two saddlebacks together, and out of a nest of four you might get two of the really good saddlebacks and two that just look like a pie bird, so you don't always get like for like. The whites, they were talking about. Who's seen a white mango? Some of the older guys?
Hey, what do you mean older guys? You just got on Superman.
When was the last time you saw a white mango, guys?
Probably in the last 15 years, if I remember.
15 years. So 15. I've done this talk out at the Carthur Club a month ago, and I put the same question to those guys. You old guys, and a few of the guys there were bird dealers. They said, "Oh, yeah, guy."